Greetings and welcome. We are jumping into our retention lab. Now it's going to be retention and eDiscovery here. So we are going to do a little bit of discovery searches. Granted, there's not a whole lot to pull up, but we're still going to do searches nonetheless. So with that being said, we're going to jump into the portal here. We're going to go to the admin center. And again, as always, we are going to show all and go to the compliance center. So far we've talked about DLP, we've talked about information protection, we've talked about sensitive information types here. Now, the last kind of bow on this trifecta, if you will, is the data lifecycle management factor. Now, this is a big deal here because retention is a very important concept. However, it is important to understand that retention and deletion are two important or two different things, very distinct. Retention is the holding of data, whereas deletion is obviously the deletion of data. So it may interchange. It's generally not a good idea to interchange those two. When we talk about retention, a lot of times people are talking about retention and deletion. But we'll get to that in time. And then the other piece that I want to say is that this is probably the most important part here. Retention of data is not a disaster recovery scenario, meaning that if we were to retain data, it is not designed to use to restore data based off of disaster recovery. Okay, that is where there is a fine line on this because, yes, it can. If we retain data, yes, we can restore it from the recoverable items, which, of course, is not that difficult, but that is not really what it's designed to do. It is not designed to restore data if people delete it or maliciously do something to it, or in that instance of catastrophic failure. Now, again, Office 365 owned by Microsoft is incredibly, hundreds of millions of people now use it. And when we're looking at it, you have to understand that, yes, they are a very responsible organization. And I can count on one hand how many times I've had any type of data loss, non-recoverable data loss. And that is a real risk because, again, a lot of time it happens when it's in motion. So when we're either migrating from on-premise to something, that happens a lot. But there are so many, we'll say, catch-alls or safety nets, I guess, if you will, that it's really difficult to truly delete data here. However, as I said, the big deal behind this here is not for disaster recovery. If Office 365 were to have problems and catastrophically lose data, okay, in that very, very small circumstance of that happening, very, very, very small circumstance of happening, there probably a lot more things would be happening. We would have a lot more to worry about. However, in that small circumstance where it happens, this is where I always talk with my customers about a third-party backup solution. This is where other backup solutions, I'm just throwing a couple out there, I'm not pegging them or anything, but I have seen in the past, eVault is one of them, I think it's a semantic product. We also have Veeam, that is another one that I've seen, and what they do is they actually take backups of data, user data, email, SharePoint, OneDrive, Teams, all of that stuff gets backed up to another location. Now we have the ability to put it into maybe like a Azure Blob storage. But again, in that mindset there, you got to kind of ask yourself too, is you got to kind of go down that rabbit hole of, all right, well, if Microsoft 365 is having a problem and catastrophically lost data, all of this stuff is in Azure. So, that doesn't necessarily make it the best place to put it. So I have had a lot of customers who go, my opinion, maybe it's a little far, but hey, I'm the one, this is not my data. So again, whatever works for you, but they've put it inside of AWS, Amazon Web Service, or Google Cloud if possible. But another option is to take it and put it into a third party location. So your data will still be resilient over there. Okay. Is that it's over there if you need to restore it. Okay. Remember, catastrophic failure. That is not what we're talking about today. Okay. What we're talking about here is retention and holding of data and deletion of data. So we're going to come over here. We're going to go to data lifecycle management. Go ahead and click on it. Now we do have an option. Microsoft has just added this on here where we have Exchange. So Exchange used to have, well, it still does. I'm not saying it doesn't. Exchange still has ways of being able to use what they used to call MRM as message retention, message retention management policies here. And what these do here is they have ways of being able to be a little bit more granular with the saving of data. let me give you an example here, is that what we can do here is we can create a new policy based off of tags. Okay, so we have to add a tag. Now, there are actually a couple tags in here. But we have these tags that are 1 month delete, 1 week delete. These are personal tags. These are users will assign tags. That's the idea of a personal tag. Now, this is inside of Exchange only. So in Outlook, I have to go into my mail and I would classify my data via personal tags. I'll be completely honest with you, never have seen it once. Nobody ever uses that. We always use default tags where we move to archive. Okay, default 2 years, move to archive. Now, this is the only circumstance here that I think it makes sense to use this. But we'll get to that in time. You see here we have deleted items, junk items. We also have the ability to customize these here a little bit more. We can kind of play around with these. We can get down to folder levels, default folder levels, that is. So again, deleted items, junk items. There are, you know, calendars, if you wish. I don't know why you would, but you could. You know, you have those types of scenarios on there. The problem with that is that starts getting very complicated when it comes to mail, and users are very, let's just say, against deletion and retention of data. They don't mind retention, but if we have delete in there, they're very much against deletion of data. So they will find ways around it. I've had and heard stories about users who will take, and like say we're doing specific folder retention, they will take their messages and throw them all into one folder that is not actually retained or deleted, and then they will keep it there forever. Just a way of circumventing the retention deletion policy. Again, it's not a good practice. It's really kind of silly, is that all emails should be retained and deleted, not just individual folders inside of the mailbox. The only one, as I said, is on here is where we get this 2 year to move to archive, where what we can do is after 2 years, we're going to take it from our mailbox and move it to the online archive. Now, we talked about those online archives in our Exchange section there, but this is a way of keeping the mailboxes clean, and I actually do like doing this. So what it's going to do is going to take all mail after 730 days, take it from the Surface mailbox and put it to the online archive mailbox. And it doesn't go away, it doesn't stay there, but it just keeps it out of the mailbox itself. Now, again, with the idea here with Exchange having at minimum 50 gigs up to 100 gig mailboxes, that's not really that big of a deal anymore because that's just a tremendous amount of data. However, I still have lots of people that fill that up. I have no idea why people do that. But a good retention policy here, again, really comes into the idea of, you know, a corporate compliance policy. So, as I said, this is for Exchange only. This has no bearing inside of SharePoint, OneDrive, Teams, you know, anything outside of Exchange. This is email only. So, again, as we discussed in the lecture, who decides to make policy, the retention policies, retention and deletion policies, maybe, depends. Who does that? Well, who does that is corporate compliance. There could be a CIO, CISO, it could be a CTO, it could be chief risk officer. I've seen a lot of people, and it really depends. And I'm not saying it has to be an O-level person either. It does not have to be an officer. It could be vice president. There's a lot of different things it could do. However, when it comes down to it, we got to really look at Exchange is just one pillar in this entire thing here. So Exchange, and we have to manage policies in Exchange. Then we would have to manage policies in SharePoint, OneDrive, Teams. You get what I'm kind of getting at here, is that starts becoming unmanageable. So what Microsoft did was they created the data lifecycle management section here, and they created retention policies and deletion policies here. And they're all under, think of this as a roof, and all of the pillars of our locations are under these, under this roof. So as you see here, we have lots of different things. We're going to get to these here in time. There are several levels of retention. As we said, we have retention policies or service side policies, which are very broad, very, very broad. And if you see right here, this is where we're going to create our very first one. So we're going to hit create mailbox, or excuse me, not mailbox, discrete policy here. We're going to call this 10-year delete mail. So we're going to just focus on mail because we're going to have a little bit different of a scenario. We're only going to focus, I have it not exclamation point, I meant one. So 10-year delete mail. So what we're going to do here is maybe I'll shore this up here. Retain then delete mail, just to make sure you kind of hammer that point home. Is that so 10 years we're going to retain the data and then we're going to delete the mail. So we're going to hit next. We don't care about a description here. So now we have an option of doing adaptive or static. Now again, in the lecture, we talked about the differences here, but adaptive, as the name applies here, are going to be, they kind of are modular. They will change based off of statistics or attributes. What we're going to focus on here is static, because again, we're going to be very broad with these. Okay. Next. So here are all of the locations, and again, all of the pillars inside of this roof. And you can see there's a ton of them. We have, you know, Yammer, we have Teams, and we can separate the differences. Private channels, chats, channel messages, Yammer community messages versus user messages, Exchange public folders. I did not talk about public folders in my Exchange thing because I believe they should all go away. And that's my two cents on them. Skype for Business doesn't exist anymore, but it is still an option. It will eventually go away here in time because everything obviously has moved to Teams. But we may have a Skype for Business on-premise or some, we'll say, outliers. Don't care about that one. Groups, we're not going to care about here right now because, again, we don't care about the group data. What we care about here is going to be Exchange and Exchange only. So we're going to go ahead and uncheck SharePoint, uncheck OneDrive. We'll create a separate policy for those in time. So users here, and again, we have the option of including or excluding, just as we see here. So what do we want to do here? Well, we can choose all recipients or some recipients. Here's the thing about this here, is we can choose groups here. However, it is not a good idea. You see this all employees group here we can do. We can pick specific users. Well, here's the problem is it is not supported to have any more than at one point in time, it was supported or not supported to have any more than, I think it was like 100 users. It's either 100 or 1,000. I don't quite remember. To have individual users selected in here or a group of 100 or over 1,000. It's not really good for that. That's what the adaptive scopes are for. But in this instance here, we want to be very broad. So maybe we want to just have one or two users. I have seen it before where like the CEO and the owner of the company has a specific one. And then the rest of the organization has that. It depends, you know, and I'm not going to say one way is good or not. But when it comes down to it, I'm all about simple. Let's keep it simple. We're going to apply this to everybody in the organization. So we're going to hit next. And then here we have four options. You only see there's three here, of course, but there are actually four options here total. Remember, we're going to retain content and then we're going to delete it. So we are retaining for what this policy was, 10 years. So we're going to choose 10 years. We can always choose custom. We can go down to months, days. It only runs once a day, give or take. It runs in the back end. Exchange works a little bit differently, but generally speaking, and actually it could take up to a week to run in certain circumstances. So we're just going to keep this at 10 years since that is one of the defaults that are on there. So we're going to pick it. Now we have the retention period based on when items were created or when they were last modified. When they were last modified is generally not one of the easiest ones, but that is if people were to, again, modify it, you know, if I were to respond to an email, reply to it, pull it back up kind of from the depths, it would extend that. And then anything that is not heavily used would kind of start falling away after 10 years. It depends. I don't really see it too frequently in the wild there just because it's not as useful. Maybe it has a little bit more use case in the file field as opposed to emails because, again, nobody's really going through their old emails to bring them kind of back up to the depths, from the depths, I suppose. So I don't see that too frequently. However, this one is when the item was created. So in this instance here is upon delivery or upon message creation. So if I send it. Then after a period of time, we can delete items or do nothing. So really what this means here is that I can have, if I keep it exactly as you see here on the screen, 10 years of data, and then we are deleting it. But we are retaining the items. Remember, they are retained, which means they will never fully be deleted until the 10-year mark hits, no matter what the users do. It retains all of their statuses. It retains every bit of it. It is always there. Okay. So in this instance here, we are going to retain all of the items for 10 years and then delete the items. That is what we truly want to accomplish, and that's probably one of the easiest things to do, most common things that I would see here. However, we do have an option, which is do nothing. So in this one here is we are guaranteeing our data is going to be around for 10 years, and then afterwards, it can still stick around if the users don't delete it. But if the users delete it, it'll go about its normal, you know, deprovisioning, if you will. But this instance here is where guaranteeing data is around for 10 years. And then after that, it may be around if somebody manually deletes it. But again, Everybody's a digital hoarder nowadays, so we don't ever really see that. We do have this one here. This one makes me shudder. Retain items forever. I hate this option here, but it is an option, and it really depends on corporate compliance policies. This is one of those scenarios where customers think that retention policies are designed for disaster recovery, and if we don't ever want to delete anything ever again, we can always restore it if needed. Not a good plan. It's really not a good plan because you're going to just hit your store. You do have storage limits, you know, especially inside of SharePoint. You have storage limits. So you got to be careful if you're retaining data forever. So again, everybody is just a digital hoarder now. We do also have this final option here, which is only delete items. So we are not actively retaining the items, which means if somebody deletes it before the 10 years or whatever period of time we said here is up, the data will be gone. But no data in our organization will be older than, again, in this instance, 7 years, but let's pick 10. No data will be older than 10 years. So we are retaining data for a specific, or excuse me, we're not retaining data, but we are deleting items after they have reached a certain age. So again, based off of what we set out to create, we are going to retain items for 10 years and then delete. So that is the policy that we have gone out to set. Now, again, looking at what we have set it to, we have set to all recipients, so everybody in the organization inherits this policy. And as you see here, we're done. Items that are currently older than 10 years will be deleted after you turn on the policy, which of course we don't. This is just a trial attendant here, so there's no way that you have that kind of data on here. However, as you see up here, like I said, remember, it could take up to a week for the MRM guy in the background to run. So it is not an instant thing. And this is one of those things that you just have to wait. Now, of course, we don't have any data that's 10 years. We don't really care. We've seen data be deleted. We don't care about that, and I'm not going to demonstrate that here for you. So again, not a big deal. So we've set out to create a policy for mail. Easy enough. 10-year retain, then delete the mail. We can create another retention policy here. Is we're going to keep 20-year retain files, then delete. So in an option here, we may not want to do this. Maybe we just want to retain files only. I got two spaces in between there. There we go. So we're going to 20-year retain files only. So we're not going to delete mail. Or excuse me, we're not going to delete files. We're going to create this as another static. And where are files stored? Well, SharePoint, OneDrive. Groups, maybe, but this is, you see there's a little Outlook on here. So this is really for the Outlook group data. So the data inside of Exchange is really what's big on here. Now, there's lots of things to talk about with that one there, but this is for the groups themselves. I don't see this one used too frequently, mainly because I do not see a lot of people use M365 groups for distribution of email. They are heavily used for Teams chats, channels, and all of that, and SharePoint, but I don't really see them used too much for Exchange mail. That's just the sad nature of it. So we're going to just uncheck that here. Now, let's take a step back here, and if you have watched the modern workspace one where we talked about OneDrive and SharePoint, you'll know that SharePoint sites should be treated differently than OneDrive sites. OneDrive sites are dedicated towards specific users, whereas SharePoint sites are dedicated towards groups and they persist. SharePoint sites should be treated as a department file share, so they should stick around for periods of time. And every time I ask my customers about, okay, when we talk about retention and deletion of data, they always are focusing on email. Well, that's not really all you should be focusing on. Remember, what drives retention and deletion? It's a corporate compliance policy, but it's all about e-discovery. At this point here, and I always ask them, is that, all right, well, you're focused on email, but what are you doing right now for your file shares on premise? And they say, oh, well, we don't even touch those. And I'm like, well, again, you got to now look at it as that this is a location where we can apply policies and start having this look around. But again, does it make sense for all of these? In this instance here, we're going to keep data for 20 years and then do nothing with it. So the SharePoint site, we will guarantee that all of the data, all of the sites, will be around for a period of time. The data inside them will be around for a period of time, 20 years in this instance. And then they'll still persist afterwards unless somebody actively deletes them. So we're just going to keep both of these checked, hit next. Now remember, we have a 20-year one on here. So we're going to put 20 in there, and then we're going to do nothing. So again, we are not deleting the items inside of SharePoint and OneDrive. We are only retaining them for 20 years. Looks good. We'll submit. Okay. It's created. Again, weak. Just the way it is. So we're retaining files. We're retaining mail and then deleting the mail. So no more than 10 years of mail. However, we have guaranteed 20 years of files, but they're not going anywhere after that 20-year period. So now, looking at all of the pieces that we've looked at here so far, we have looked at very broad brushstrokes, okay? But what if we need to be a little bit more, well, I'll spoil it here, adaptive to these? We don't want all SharePoint sites. We don't want all, we'll say, I don't know, users, specific types of users, or all mail of their, you know, email to go away. Maybe we want specific users. Maybe we want specific groups of people that people come in and out of. As I said, when we create a server-side one, it is just really not a good practice to use groups inside of there. That's why the adaptive scopes are created. Keep in mind, what you have just seen here from the retention side is a E3 license functionality. It is also an E1 license functionality. But adaptive scopes do require an E5 license. So we're going to come over here and hit adaptive scopes. And you'll see that we have nothing. But let's create some adaptive scopes. So we're going to hit create. Now, what we're going to do here is we're going to do more of department-based scopes. Okay? So what we're going to do is HR files keep for 7 years. Spell that correct. Files. There we go. HR files keep for 7 years. What's an HR file? Well, we don't know, but we do know what their sites are. Okay, so we're going to do SharePoint sites. Now, here's where we can get very crazy with these here. So I'm going to try and keep it as simple as possible. Here are the properties that I can use. We can use a site URL, site name, or any of the 100 refinable strings inside of SharePoint. So if you are a SharePoint person, refinable strings are very similar to, or excuse me, if you're not a SharePoint person, refinable strings are very similar to, think about it almost as like a extension attribute inside of Active Directory, where you have the ability to put things in here and be able to, they're just kind of like a holder location. So we can use the refinable strings, but I actually like using the site name because this actually falls into a governance policy, which again, we talked about during our modern workplace section around SharePoint sites and groups. And when we create them, we want to put some sort of naming governance around it. So maybe all of our HR sites are created through maybe an automated process or maybe IT creates them. So what we can do here is that it starts with, and we'll do a 2-digit code. So if it starts with HR and then maybe IT and then maybe, you know, whatever, accounting, AC for accounting, you know, whatever we want to do, whatever we adhere to, we can follow that, and then all of the sites that are created automatically have some sort of department code attached to them. So we can include this in a, we'll just say a custom, maybe a team creation app or a SharePoint site app, like an actual power app or something like that, like a flow, where people go in and they request the team, and then, you know, hey, here's the naming governance that automatically gets added to it, and it's going to be, you know, HR-Sally's team, whatever. But as long as it's HR in front of it, guess what? It's going to fall within this category. There's the scope. We've created the scope. HR files keep for 10 years is what we've created here. Now, we probably should have called this HR sites as opposed to HR files because I was thinking of, I guess, a little too far ahead, but it doesn't matter here. What we'll do here is we'll also create IT files just to make it easy. Oh, I keep doing that. SharePoint sites, and then we will do a property of site name, starts with IT. And then we can add additional ones on here if we wanted. We can build a very crazy query here if we want to do K-queries or anything like that. Again, that's a lot. Let's just keep it simple for now. All right, cool. So we have these two adaptive scopes. I wonder if I can edit the name of this. I can't. So what we'll do here is just, we'll go ahead and delete that one, and we'll just do HR files here. just so I can make sure we all understand it. HR files, SharePoint sites, site name starts with HR. Okay, so you see we have our two scopes here. So what we can do then is we can come over to the retention policies, and this is where we would say HR files keep for 7 years. Come over here and we have an adaptive scope. We can hit next on it. We can add the scope here, which we have for HR files. Looks good to me. So these are obviously going to include SharePoint sites. And we're good. It's going to be all SharePoint sites, but only ones that specifically fit the HR scope. Hit next. We're going to retain for 7 years and do nothing afterwards. Next. Submit. So at this point here, it doesn't like the name of it because I already created it before. So let me go ahead and we'll call this new. We got scope on there. Next. Make sure it does nothing. Good. All right. Looks good there. We'll go ahead and submit it now. So as it stands right now is we have a retention policy that does not delete. It only keeps HR files. For whatever reason, it created that twice. So I'll delete the one. I don't know why I did create that one twice. It's interesting. But neither here nor there. So HR files keep for 7 years. Looks good. Then we can do a retention policy for, you know, IT files keep for, I don't know, we'll do 8 years. Why not? Then delete. So we're going to delete the files. Adaptive, add the scope, IT files. Yes, and then we're going to delete automatically. Okay, there we go. So you can see on here, so you can get an idea of where we're getting at here. Now, we looked at the file side of things, but again, what about, I don't know, managers? So these would be users. So in this instance here, I can use these attributes. I can have department, job title. Maybe we'll do job title is equal to manager. And then maybe we want to add an attribute. And we can do or job title is equal to supervisor. You know, whatever we do. And we can have it. It could be any of those. Then we submit. So we got managers on here. So let's come over here and we will put the final little, we'll do manager keep data for 5 years. No delete. It's an adaptive one. Add scopes. Managers. And as you see on here, we have OneDrive and email here. We can include Teams if we wanted to on this, but I'm not going to because that's a little... it's a little too much in my personal opinion, but we can do this. These are personal chats and private channel messages. And then Yammer user, or these, think of these as Yammer DMs, if you will. But again, these are all tied to users, so we can delete data based off of that. Okay, well, we're just going to delete their items. That's why I didn't put files or emails. And I forget how long I was going to set this for. Let's go back. 5 years, no delete. So what ends up happening is as I'm creating users, we're going to, our users are going to fall into these categories here. You know, we may have sites that are HR sites. They'll keep around for a while. IT sites, again, they'll keep around for a period of time, then delete, and then managers. So as I am creating users, these policies are adaptive. So I don't have to come in here and change these policies. As I, again, create and customize the users, these policies will apply to them. Now, that is kind of the next level of granularity in terms of adaptive scopes. These are actually fantastic. I love adaptive scopes. I think they are fantastic to do. However, we can go down a little bit more granular, and this is kind of the final level and the final granularity of retention as a whole, retention and deletion. So if we hit labels, so again, very similar to the way we have seen before with sensitivity labels, we can use retention labels. Now, these are different. Okay, and these are actually applied differently. These are a little bit different here in terms of how they work, because they actually do give us another option as opposed to just retaining and deleting. We can have a little bit more of a granularity with it. So in this instance here, we're going to create a label. And remember that sensitive information type that we had for Project X? Keep for 2 years, then dispose. So dispose is a little bit different, or disposition, if you will. So here's the description. We don't care. We don't need a description because, again, I'm telling you what it is here. So Project X. You remember that sensitive information type that we created for Project X? Well, we're going to use that one here. So what we can do here is we can label items. So this is just for classifications. We can retain items indefinitely, which, again, never want to do that. We want to enforce actions after a specific period. So what's the period? What did we say it was? Custom, we said it was 2 years. Now, we also have a new option on here. So as opposed to when they were created versus when they were last modified, we also have the ability of when they were labeled. So when that label was slapped on them, then they will start the retention. So that comes into play here in a little bit, but we're just going to do when items were created for now. We can change the label or delete the items. So this one we can get very complex here. Is that, hey, we want to put another label on it that's, you know, keep it for whatever, keep it for this period of time and such. We can do that. So these are options that we have, or we can just outright delete them. So one of the things that I also want to, we need to go back just to show, oops, didn't want to go that far. What we can do in this as well is that we can start tying in, we'll continue down, delete them automatically. We'll go ahead and create that label here. But what we'll do is tie in some MRM features of Office 365 once this is done. There we go. So we're going to do nothing with the label for the time being. And then what we're going to do here is we're just going to have a label called keep for 10 years. We'll get to that in a second here, because we're actually going to use both of these. That Project X one we're going to use is that is going to be an automatic one. Retain items forever. We're going to delete. I don't know. What do we want to do here? So we can retain items. I think we said for 10 years on this one here, based off of what is this? These are new things. This is called event-driven retention. So what we can do here is we can tie in other systems. Okay, so let's just say we have a document management system, and this is a very common scenario. We have a customer relations manager. How about that? A CRM. You know, we enter our, you know, our potential prospects and everything in there, and then they have events that happen over there. So let's just say that we have a vendor that we work with, and we keep track of that vendor inside of our CRM, and we keep track of that contract in there. And we deal with the vendor, and we have a corporate compliance policy that says we keep all contracts based off of 10 years after the contract has been fulfilled, okay? So once the contract has been fulfilled, 10 years after that, we keep the data. So in this instance here, what we can do is we can create events. Now, these are just, you know, right here, it's termination of contract or agreement. You can see that these are three. We can create brand new ones here too. But for instance, we can have an expiration or termination of contracts. Cool, we can create a new one here as well, whatever we want to do. But what happens here is that we have probably hundreds of different kinds of contracts in there. But certain contracts are specific. So what will end up happening is that we will keep the data or the email. It's a file, okay? It's a contract, so it's a file. This file is labeled with this retention label, and it just sits there and it does nothing. It literally does nothing until in our document management system or our CRM, wherever we're keeping track of those contracts, it says it's expired. Then we can actually dump that information into Office 365 via an API that says that vendor X has terminated their contract. And then at that point there, everything that is labeled with this label for keep for 10 years for vendor X, everything that is labeled as such will start the timer, but only when that event is driven. Okay, So there's lots of things that we can do here, of course, but this one requires quite a lot. But remember when I was talking about a disposition? So after the retention period happens, okay, we can start a disposition review. We can also change the label, but let's look at a disposition review. Let's look what it says. Start the disposition reviewers. Let them decide the next steps. Can this be safely deleted, or we need to retain the period? So we can do here is we can create stages. You can have up to 5 stages. That's quite a lot, but you could. And you can actually set these dispositions. So, you know, we'll call it first stage. Hit OK on that. So we're going to search for people. So in this instance here, Getty Lee is going to be our first stage disposition reviewer. And he's going to get, when things are coming up for retention, when things are coming up for deletion, Getty Lee is going to get an email. He's going to come into the portal. He's going to look at everything that's up for deletion today. Then he's going to choose. All right, delete, yes, no. All right, well, this one here we need to keep for another 10 years. Nope, nope, nope. And then it goes into another stage. And then those people look at what Getty did. And then they just keep adding on to it. So you can have up to 5 stages of that. So here's the first stage where Getty Lee comes in and does his kind of initial look and starts the disposition review process. So we'll create that label on there. As I said, this one here starts getting to the very complicated piece of the puzzle. We're going to create one additional label that's going to publish out to people. Just a simple, we'll do nothing here. And then we'll just do just another simple one, keep for 1 year. And then this is going to be very, very easy. So we can retain items for a period of time. And we want to retain for custom 1 year based off of when they were done. And then what we want to do, automatically delete it. Sounds good. We can deactivate retention settings. So then, again, you have to remove them. So this is kind of the do nothing action as we saw before. So we'll delete items automatically. And there we go. Now it's out there. So we're going to do nothing here for the time being. All right. So there's a couple things that we have and that we saw before is that we have the option of doing manual versus automatic. So in this instance here, we can do manual. So again, let's try to look at here, for instance, keep for 10 years and keep for 1 year. Well, in this instance here, we have to come over here to label policies, just like we did with the sensitivity labels. These labels here are the actions of things that we're going to do of the content. And then these over here are going to be how the labels are to whom they're going to be published. So we're going to hit publish labels. Choose the labels that we want to publish. We're going to keep for 10 years and keep for 1 year. We'll take that Project X one off to the side for just a minute. Hit next. We can do this to an adaptive scope of people. Again, maybe they have a group of users that are they have an extension attribute in there, or maybe we can just do static. In this instance, we're just going to do static because we did not create an adaptive scope for all these people. We can choose the locations we want to publish these to: SharePoint, OneDrive, Groups, or Exchange. We're just going to do everything, and we're going to call this PSP retention labels, and we're going to submit. At that point there, we have published out these labels to people. Okay, so those two labels are going to come out to people. And just as we did before, they're going to kind of just wait. We have to wait for them to kind of get published out to people. But what we're also going to do here is we're going to do auto-applying label. Now, one of the options that we used to have, or we had on the sensitivity side there, is we can do inline as people are typing in data. We don't have that option here, mainly because it's way too complicated for a user, and it would be too intrusive. So we're going to say here, this is Project X. We'll just call it Project X, it's fine. So if you see here is that we can apply a label to cloud attachments and share in OneDrive or Exchange in Teams. We can train up a classifier, sensitive info, or specific words or properties. So in this instance here, since we already have one, we're just going to use the sensitive info. We'll do a custom one. Now this should start looking very normal to you because again, we've already seen this before, sensitive info type. Now remember, we have a Project X. created that one. So we'll use that. Now we can also use just use a word too if we want. Content that contains a word. Sure, we can do that. Now, who do we want to apply this to and where do we want to apply this to? We're going to do static. We are, or can, here in this instance, do Exchange, SharePoint, OneDrive, or Groups. So in this instance here, it only applies to Microsoft 365 Group SharePoint sites. SharePoint sites also would be included here too. So we can kind of go back and forth. Is that SharePoint sites that are created from a group versus SharePoint sites as a whole, which could include communication sites and such too. We're just going to keep everything on here because why not? You know, why not? In this instance here, we're going to Project X. Next, and then we're going to submit. So what's going to end up happening here, it's going to find all of the data that has Project X in it, okay? Because it has that sensitive info. And it is going to automatically apply this Project X label. Now, I do have the then dispose, but I set up the disposition on the other one, but you get the idea here. Don't worry about the names too much, but just understand that the auto labeling piece here is, you know, it's kind of running there in the back end. And we can see it here. It's just going to take some time for it to run. You can see it's enabled pending, and it's going to take some time. Now, one last thing I want to tell you about retention policies, retention labels, label policies. And if you look down here, if I click on this here, you will see there is an option for preservation lock. This is a spooky thing. You got to be careful. This requires, and there is one very small circumstance. I don't know the actual compliance name. There's an industry compliance. I don't know what the actual title of it is, but there is a specific one that applies to when we create a corporate retention policy and we set the policy, we can do a preservation lock, which means that these policies that we create cannot be touched for a period of time. And then we're talking years. I had a customer that set it for 100 years, and they were retaining all data in the tenant. They didn't know what they were doing. So when they put preservation lock on, it locked the policy. We were unable to change the policy. You can't delete the policy. You can't remove those retentions. You can't do anything. We were locked completely. What happens there is that there's you can only raise that preservation lock. You cannot lower that preservation lock. There's only one way to do it, and Microsoft has to do it. You have to actually, there's a crazy, like the CEO of the company has to have like letterhead and have some sort of special letter that they have to send. It's very crazy of what ends up happening, but there is a process to get over it if needed. But again, keep in mind, preservation lock is designed for one specific compliance policy, a type that's for an industry level compliance. And I want to say it's somewhere in the finance sector. I don't know off the top of my head though. I've never actually seen that one actually be utilized. I've only actually seen it used in incorrect manners, as I just explained to you there. Just a little FYI more than anything. So again, looking through these here, we've already looked at the scopes, we looked at the labels, we looked at the policies. Policy lookup here, this just will give us like, hey, if I look up a user, what policies are going to be applied? Or again, in terms of a site, if I want to search for a site, we can see which ones are going to apply to it. Just a kind of a checker. We don't have anything there, so we don't really care. And then we have these two, which is import and archive. So import allows us to, this one's a kind of a weird one, how they just kind of added this. I don't know. It's a little weird where they put it here, but these are for import of PST files. Now, if you know what a PST file is, then you know that they are pure evil. They are a way of being able to take your data and store it to a local cached copy on the computer itself. And from a management perspective, they're very evil. You cannot e-discover them. You can't look at them. You can't do anything. Microsoft wants you to kind of get rid of them. So what they do is they give you an option to import PSTs to the portal here, and you can ingest them into all of the individual mailboxes. What you can do here is, and you can even see here, depending on how many you have of them, you can actually ship a encrypted hard drive to Microsoft, or you can upload directly from the network. Either one of those are options there. All right. Last here, a little archive. Who has archive mailboxes enabled or disabled? Now, in our instance here, because we set this up here, if we were in a hybrid scenario, we would not be able to do this. That has to be done from on-premise. But if we wanted to, let's just say Neil, we wanted to put his archive mailbox on. Whenever this comes up here, maybe we can just click this one here. So there we go. Neil. It's going to take a minute or so, but Neil will have an archive mailbox and he will be enabled. That's all. Really nothing special there, so we can actually take mail from our main mailbox and ship it over to the archive if needed. So that's all for that one there. Not that big of a deal here. All right, so since we are still waiting on the labels, the last piece that I want to show you here is eDiscovery. Okay, so we're going to come down here to eDiscovery. And you'll notice that there are lots of different types of eDiscovery. Standard, premium, and user data search. This is a new user data search here, but what we can do here is data subject requests. So this is new because it's actually part of down here where subject writes request. It's weird that they kind of move that all over there, but it's all over the place now. But essentially what this is I can be a user and I can search for what kind of privacy data do you have on me as a person. That is some compliance in certain levels. That sometimes happens with California has CCPA, New York has something, I forget what theirs is actually called, but you know, GDPR. There's a lot of, we'll say, geographically located compliance levels that we have to look at here. I'm not going to worry too much about this one here because this one is in the process of moving. And they're going to make a couple of changes to the tool too. So I have naturally ever seen this. I've never seen anybody utilize it, but it's there. Then we have standard and premium eDiscovery. Here's the big difference between the two. eDiscovery standard is for everything within the Office 365 ecosystem. SharePoint, Teams, OneDrive, Exchange, blah, 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 blah. All of those, it's all inside of that ecosystem. Premium allows us to be able to look at external investigations. So this requires, well, a lot, because it also does require a connector. And we have to do a connector to, there's a lot of different things here. This one can get complicated. But we can create a connector. So let's just say we use Zoom and Slack as two different, Discord or something like that too we use. But again, we want to be able to search those locations, not just Office 365. Well, we have this eDiscovery Premium here where we can create API connectors so it can go out and search for that data as well. This gets very, very complicated here, and I've only had a few that I've actually seen in the wild that use the Premium eDiscovery for its true intended purpose. But again, you do have the ability to, didn't mean to click on that, you do have the ability to get very complicated here, okay? So let's start first with just the standard. We're not going to really do much with the premium here, but we're going to just start with a very simple standard one. So the way eDiscovery works inside of Office 365 is all based off of cases. So we can create a case. And this is going to be for legal case XYZ, because I'm very creative. So when we create a case, think of this as a bucket. I don't know if that actually saved. Try that again, I suppose, unless it actually did create in there. I don't know. Come on. All right, portal is not being nice to me right now. Let's see if I can go off of it and come back into it. Well, maybe we'll give it a second here. This happens from time to time. It gets hung up here when it's trying to render the web parts inside of here. I've seen that, especially with the eDiscovery, but I also see that a lot with the data classification side too. I don't know, maybe premium works? Premium seems to be working. Well, not entirely either. Maybe it knows. Oh, so it just completely hosed up on me here. So, okay, well, it looks like it did work in the back end here, and I have no idea what that was. We'll chalk it up to kind of a weirdy. Not a problem, though. So as you see on here, we have legal case XYZ. Think of these as buckets, okay? So the thing that's fantastic about these here are what we do here is, again, you got to really think about it from IT's perspective in the corporate compliance world. IT should be facilitating these searches and everything like that, but IT should not be doing the searches. And I know that's probably different than if you have ever done any type of legal searches or anything like that. It's probably something that you have not seen, because normally IT are the only ones who can do this. Well, in this instance here, what we can do is we can take this case and we can delegate this out to people. We want to say, all right, well, here you go, lawyer, and all of your legal aides and all of your, you know, associates and everybody that you work with. Here you go. We're going to delegate this out to you. You have permission to this case. You can do whatever you want inside of this case. And at that point there, they can come in, they can do the searches, the holds, and the exports. And the great thing about it is that when you give them access to a case, they only have access to just that one case, not all of the cases. So, taking back here from the home section all the way to kind of going from left all the way to right, in the home section here, we have the case, we can close it, and we can delete the case. Now, that really depends on the scenario. Sometimes we want to keep the case open for a while. Sometimes we want to close the case, keep it closed, but not delete it. So again, we have options here. If we close it, the reason why we would do that is because, you know, maybe we need to bring it back open here and re-hold data or re-search for data, whatever it may be. So we can hold it for a period of time here as well. So once we have this case and we want to do an e-discovery, what we do here is a search. So a search is nothing more than a content search. It's the exact same thing. So this little guy over here says content search. It's the exact same thing. We create a new search, and we want to find, we're going to look for all of G. Lee's emails. So we could search here. Remember, there's really only two places that data is stored inside of Office 365, Exchange and SharePoint. So we can say, all right, well, we want to find all of his emails. So we're just going to choose one user, Geddy Lee. Done. We can also do locations on hold. Now, we can't do anything that because we haven't done anything with hold yet. So we'll readdress that here in a minute. This one here, app content for on-premise users, this is only for a circumstance in which you are in a hybrid Exchange format and you are using Teams. All of your mailboxes exist on-premise, but you are using Teams. You actually have a mailbox that is provisioned up in the cloud for your team's data. It's very complicated. It's kind of outside of the scope here. We don't care. It doesn't matter. We can just leave it checked. It's not going to do anything. But we'll just keep that there. That is all for that. That is all that that one is specifically used for. So don't worry too much about that. We'll hit next. Now at this point here, we can build conditions or we can use KQueries. So keywords generally are easy, but maybe in this instance here, we just want to look for... Here's the dates. So we don't care about keywords here, but we want all information between these months. Okay, that's what we're doing. Now we can also look for who they sent to, who the sender, when they sent it. We can do last modified, file type. If we were to include SharePoint in here, we would be able to get a whole lot more of information. So let's just do all of the mail during this time frame. That's easy enough. So what's going to end up happening is we're going to do a content search. And it is starting right now, but it's going to do a content search for these specific things. So again, in this instance here, this is really what we're looking for, and what they're searching for is really going to be dictated by the litigation aspect of it. It's going to say we want all mail from blah, blah, and this time and that frame and who was included in it and such. But that's, again, that's a lawyer thing. So this is another one of those ethical pieces that we want to start looking at here is that I'm an administrator. I can just start looking at mail if I want to start doing e-discovery searches and such. Well, do we want to? I don't know. That's an option, but we do. As you see here, he's got 101 items and actually has found it. So searched by me, and you can see that it finished. It's just really easy. Well, it was a pretty small little mailbox. So you can see 101, one location, 6.4 data. Basically, here's the Exchange. Top locations, well, of course, are going to be his mailbox. Now, in this option here, I can export the results, export a report, copy the search, recreate it, rerun it. I can also review a sample. So this is going to give me a little sample, and this one here is sometimes very notorious for not loading, as you see on here. Maybe if we try to load more items, no. Yeah, this one's very notorious. And plus, we're also pushing it very, very fast. But if we open it up here, maybe we want to get this mail. So what we can do here is we can export the results. So exporting the results isn't as easy as you may think, and it's designed to be. Because remember, this is a data exfiltration piece here. We got to be very, very careful. So in this instance here, what we could do is that we're going to include all items, excluding ones that have an unrecognized format, are encrypted or weren't indexed for other reasons. Just says that for whatever. So we can include those if we want, or basically it's generally best to boot this. We can also, now remember I said PSTs were evil. Well, that's what it's actually going to be in, because a lot of times that's what it has to be in as well. So again, we can do a PST for each mailbox, one PST containing all mail messages, all P messages in one single folder, or individual messages. That's a nightmare, but still an option here. So we have 100 of them. So we're going to export this as just one PST for mailbox. Oh, we got a 500 error. Lovely. Let's see if we can try and do this again. Great. All right, let's see if we can try and maybe manipulate this a little bit different. We'll do one PST containing all of them. And we will do all items excluding the junk ones. No. And of course, still getting an error on here. It probably is because I just started this here, and it probably actually hasn't fully, even though it says it's complete, it probably hasn't finished it. So we'll come back to that in time. Let's jump over here to Holtz. So we've done our searches here, okay? And we have all of the data that we're looking at. You know, here's the search. We've refined our searches, okay? So what we can do then is we can do a hold. Now there's two ways to do holds. There's a in-place hold or a litigation hold. In-place hold is what you're seeing right here. So this is create a hold to preserve content. So remember, as I've done my search, you know, I found my search of these emails, and I actually find all of the data that I specifically want. Well, if we have a retention policy across the board, we're still covered on that data. That's fine. But if we create a gle hold, but if we create a, let's just say a, some of that data is, you know, litigation could go on for years. So some of that data may actually go beyond the retention period. Let's say we have a 2-year retention period. And that legal case maybe is going on beyond that. So some of this mail may go away during that litigation, which is bad. So what we can do here is we can do a in-place hold based off of the criteria. Now, in this instance here, remember, we wanted through these dates. That's what we're going to do for holds. So what's going to happen here is going to find all of this data, and it's going to put it on hold for as long as this case is open, legal case XYZ. As long as it is open, it will stay held. What I mean by held is it will be retained. It will stick around forever. Even if a user tries to delete it, it'll stick around. Even if a retention policy tries to delete it, it will still stick around. These supersede retention policies for a reason of, as long as this case is open, these are active litigation and it needs to stay open. We need to still preserve this data. These will supersede a retention policy, okay? So in that instance there, when we create that hold, we're good. Now, the other way we can do a hold is through exchange, where we can find the mailbox and we can put the entirety of the mailbox on hold. So this is like a snapshot of specific data. I've picked all data out between that period of time, but anything beyond that, it's not going to be held. So an option that we can do here is that we can come over to exchange. So again, this is more for a legal case, but if we come over here to mailboxes, what we can do, and I'm just going to pick one of these other mailboxes that exist, of course, if this ever wants to load up, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the entire mailbox on litigation hold. So let's just say we'll try this admin account just because it's easier. Now let's see if I remember where they moved that all to. There is an option. Litigation hold. There we go. So I put this litigation hold and I check the switch. What's going to end up happening is that this entire mailbox and all mail goes to any mail, new mail that goes to it will stay here forever. And we can do it for a period of time or no limit. We can make a note where the user will get a thing that says, hey, your mailbox is on hold. And then we can give them some more information if we want. Now, the idea behind this here is for VIPs. This is what I see a lot here for litigation hold, is that we have people who are just, especially like HR, and kind of like, you know, high level employees, executives and such, they're always getting named in lawsuits. So a corporate policy is we just put all executives on litigation hold across the board, and they are held forever. So all data is always held for them. That's an option we can do here, and that is really what this one is designed for. Whereas this legal case over here is only for that specific period of time that I have done, or whatever snapshot I'm looking for relative to this case is being held. That's it. So it depends on the scenario, what you're looking to try and do there, but that is kind of the piece there of, you know, litigation here. So hey, we turned it on, looks good. Now, just seeing maybe if possible, this portal seems to be not liking me here tonight. Definitely not liking me tonight because now I was not even working. gotta love this. Sometimes this portal here, just as I've said 100 times, you know, it is just sometimes not pleasant to work in. Let me try it now. Nope, getting a 500 code still. Maybe I can just try to do a report instead so we can get an idea here. So as opposed to getting a PST of the data, the 500 error, it's not, it's just a unknown error. 500 errors are the most generic and vague ones that there are. So I'm going to see if I can try and get this report. Good, it's been created, so that's good at least. So we should have this report whenever this is done. It's going to come over here in the exports. Just want to make sure that it did work. Hey, there we go, this is the report. So I can take this here. Now there's a couple caveats to this, and it's actually still scheduling, hasn't even started yet. Which if I don't, by the time I finish this sentence here, if it's not done, we're not gonna worry about it. This is just a CSV or an Excel spreadsheet here of the different things inside of it, and that's all. Just gives you a report, it's helpful, because it gives you a snapshot. But what's gonna end up happening here is that we can take this report or we can take the export. Everything is located here in this export. Now that PST is not just raw, is what I was trying to get at before. It's not just a raw PST, it's actually encrypted PST. And we have to use the, it generates a certificate when you download it. And at that time when you have to decrypt it, so you can only use the passcode or the key that they give you to decrypt it. That's the only way you can access those PSTs. So the idea here is that once this case is closed, it'll kill all of those. Those PSTs are essentially just orphaned and they can't be done, nothing can be done with them. So they can be just safely deleted and disposed of. So that's all piece around it. So again, as I said, litigation holds a big, big player here, as well as eDiscovery, looking at data, making sure that it's around. Because really, when it comes down to it, the biggest piece is our corporate compliance policy says we have 10 years of data. And if you have anything less than that, you're going to be in big trouble. So that's the whole point around all these tools that we talked about here. And never once have I said anything about disaster recovery. Remember, that is not the purpose of retention. That is designed for something completely different. That is disaster recovery scenarios and such. Completely different scenario. All right, with that being said, that is it. This is part one here. We will have that part two. That part two is just going to be putting those labels onto information, and we'll start looking at the auto labeling piece there to see if it found anything with Project X in it, and we can see what kind of stuff it labeled. So with that being said, thank you for your time here on this one. We will jump over to the next one when we get to it. Thank you.